Mike Rutherford joins us in the week. The first collection of Mike and the Mechanics, the singles, is released alongside the 25th anniversary Living Years Deluxe Edition, as the first Genesis memoir is released and ahead of a national tour next month. Keeping busy then, Mike.
It's all happening. I'm still selling my wares, I feel. Book, two CDs and a tour. No, but it's great. All good stuff.
And ever so slightly croaky because of the book launch followed by...
book launch and a bit of chat yesterday. This is laryngitis rather than... rock and roll lifestyle.
So it was 25 years ago that Mike and the Mechanics were formed during a break from Genesis. What do you remember most about those early days of the Mechanics, and how was the dynamic different from Genesis, for example?
Unlike most bands who do solo stuff, you know, they do because they're unhappy with the main band. We were having a great time with Genesis. You know, the band was cooking and stuff. And then we just thought we needed a break from each other. We'd been 25 years together. And so we started doing these projects. And it was a breath of fresh air, actually, you know, just new people to play with. I found some new songwriters, B.A. Robertson and Chris Neal, and a new sort of band of players. And it was the fact it succeeded was even more surprising, really.
Let's talk about The Living Years. It's the name of the book you've just released, which is described as not just another rock and roll memoir. It's about fathers, family and friendship. There are some great stories in there as well, and some humour. From the night you spent in prison to your wife's dysentery on honeymoon, I'm sure she's thrilled that made it in the book. And I laughed out loud at the DJ who went with, "So why is the new Genesis album called And Then There Were Three?"
Yeah, that's a good line. I mean, I think what's nice is the book, anyone reads the book, they'll realise it's because my father's memoirs were unpublished and I've used them in the book. And it's more about a father-son thing. And that generational change, it's a big moment in the 60s, you know, when suddenly kids wanted to be anything but their fathers. Mm. And so it's about that and the early band days. I think more interesting than the later band days, in a way.
Did you enjoy the process of putting it together? Because I can't even begin to imagine where you start with something like that.
I had a lot of help with Angie, my wife helped me, also remembering some of the bits I couldn't remember. But
filling in the gaps.
We started with the stories, the sort of main key moments, yeah. And it was fun to do because I think there was something to say. Mm. Rather than just the facts, you know what I mean? I think, and I said to the publisher, it must be a book that could be read by anybody who's not even keen on the band or the Mechanics, so to speak. So it works as a story.
And the song, obviously, The Living Years, is just so emotive to so many people. What does it mean to you on a personal level, but also a professional level?
I think it's one of the best moments, really. I mean, we must credit B. Robertson, my co-writer, who actually wrote the lyrics, and we lost our fathers at the same time. And we had new babies, and this story about this generational change, because people today, your age, don't quite realise that in my era, you know, fathers and sons and parents didn't really talk. It wasn't their fault. Mm. They'd been through two world wars, they were shocked, tired, and there wasn't the language they shared, especially not, you know, rock and roll. My dad on the battleships, you know, very smart in his naval gear, and me with long hair and double neck guitar and a rock band. There wasn't much we could talk about, and so it was a funny time in that sense.
But I mean, reading between the lines, your father was incredibly supportive of your musical career.
He was.
And there's no sense of at any point he kind of even said, you know, oh well, all fine son, keep it as a hobby and get a proper job. That doesn't seem to come through.
I think
perhaps from uncles.
You're right. I think he was wise enough to know that actually the more he said no, the more I'll have done it. I think he thought, please, 2 years and I'll grow out of it, you know. Because in those days, you know, I mean, you see now parents pushing kids to go into music. But in those days, there was no precedent of making a living or having a life doing music.
Mm. Between Genesis and Mike and the Mechanics, you've obviously provided the soundtrack to so many people's lives. Do you get a real sense of that? Do fans kind of share what the songs mean to them? And
it's nice. I mean, I'm aware that it's a corny old phrase, soundtrack of life. It's true. Certain songs remind them of certain parts of their life, important moments. But also The Living Years is something even more than that. I mean, BA and I get letters all the time, people who actually lost touch with their fathers, you know, and sort of hadn't really sort of had communication and heard a song and rang them up. So that's changed someone's life, which is amazing, really.
You're living the dream of so many people. And, you know, it was your dream when at 15 you formed Genesis. How does the dream compare to the reality?
It's never as good as it should, because there's always something that's you never get there. I mean, it sounds awfully corny to say, you never feel you've arrived, ever feel you've written, there's always a better song to write, you know, there's always stuff to do. You never quite get there. Although doing the book has been a nice moment, looking back, and nice too, remembering all the memories with Peter and Phil and Tony and all that sort of stuff. It's been a nice time to sort of reflect on all that.
There are some real highlights. Some low moments as well. There's one particular part of the book that stuck with me was when you come back from tour and seen your daughter and you felt like a little bit of a stranger to her, and it was quite upsetting to you.
That really sort of struck me, actually, as suddenly realising what had happened. I hadn't been around her very much. She was awkward with me. Mm. It was a difficult time in that sense. And also in the 80s, you know, when my father died, I was in that sort of bubble. You know, it was all going so well. Invisible Touch tour, the Mechanics were in the top of the charts all around the world, especially in America. I could do no wrong, and I was kind of busy being successful and not really thinking about my parents. And then my father died, and then the shock comes, really.
Mm. It's always endlessly fascinating to me, the songwriting process, how a song comes together. Do you start with the concept? Do you start with the chords? Do you start with the lyrics? How do you know, for instance, it's a mechanic song compared with a Genesis song?
That's a 10-part question. I think, really, to be honest, no. All I've learned is that you can't really analyse it too much. You know what I mean? You can't try too hard. I can do more in 10 good minutes than 10 bad days, you know. And you just have to just have a feel that's good. Try, you know, get your ears listening. Is that a good bit? Are you kidding? It's a good bit. It's a really good bit, you know, and just develop it. If the lyric comes at the same time, that's great. Mm. It often doesn't, but if it does, that's a real plus. And just sort of feeling your way. Some of the best songs, you don't know you've done them. Over My Shoulder took about 10 minutes to write, myself and Paul Carrack, you know?
Really?
And Follow Me, Genesis lyric, took about 10 minutes to write too. And then I go, it can't be that easy, you know? So things, you know, things just happen that way.
Finally then, this kind of latest incarnation, which isn't so latest now, Mike and the Mechanics came together a few years ago now. I've seen Andrew Roachford take to vocals, who carries that soulful style so well. And I know you've said it all felt very natural when you came together. Was it meant to be?
I think Andrew had in his mind that Genesis was sort of a thinking man's band, you know what I mean? Conscious of the chords and the keys and the notes. And when we started playing together, he was nicely surprised that I just mess around, you know. I'm kind of, as with Tony Banks and Phil, when we write, we just do anything, you know, bash the chords out, train smashes, you know. It's kind of like jazz, really. It's so unthought about, you know. It's so organic, which Andrew is. And we've become a good writing team, actually. I just seen the other day, he sounds great over guitars. And like, I must write some songs with heavier guitars, because actually his voice sounds so good over that. In sort of mechanic style, we found a way.
Listen, best of luck for the tour, and thank you so much for coming in. It's been a real pleasure.
Thanks very much.